Hey, cure friends, welcome to the show. It's the Holy Hour podcast, the usually bi-weekly all cure podcast. I'm Gavin, but yep, we got a little bonus episode for you guys here to fill in the weeks. There's a new song floating around out there that has our boy Robert Smith on it. We figured we would give you our 2 cents on that while it's still fresh in everybody's ears. So we're happy to have a little extra episode here and a new song by CHVRCHES featuring Robert Smith. And a great episode ahead with Chaz and I just kind of doing our mind dump on this whole new song. But before we roll into it, I want to give a big shout out to our Patreon crew with Donna, Craig, Jeff, Matt, and Jeff, and Suzanne, and John, and Lisa up in Calgary, who wants you to know about Dickens, the pub up there that's been doing live streams on Tuesdays and Wednesdays and Fridays, where they're DJing all of our favorite kind of tunes. You can find that on Tuesday and Wednesday nights at 8 Mountain Standard Time and on Fridays at 9 Mountain Standard Time. So again, that's on Twitch if you want to watch the live stream and turn the lights up or down, whatever you need to do to have yourself a wonderful dance party in your own home. So check that out at Dickens YYC. Also want to give a shout out to our friend Kate's website, curethreads.com, where you can find all kinds of cure-related merch. Her original artwork and designs placed on all kinds of products. They have these brand new flip-flops with caterpillar art that she's created. It's really cool. Some really good non-cure-related stuff over there, too. There's currently a pair of flip-flops that have OMD nod, the flowers from the Locomotion single, if you remember that one, and it looks really cool. So lots of good stuff over there to check out at curethreads.com. Over there you can also pick up her new book, The Secret Life of the Sloth, where she did wonderful illustrations. It's a great children's book that I enjoy reading thoroughly with my son, and he loves it, and it's really cool, and the illustrations are beautiful. So go check out Secret Life of the Sloth and some of the past books as well. We also want to give a big shout out to Scott's podcast, his Star Wars podcast, the Sarlacc Digest, where it's a really awesome Star Wars podcast you can find on YouTube and everywhere that you find podcasts. But they do a live show every Monday nights at 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. So right now they're doing them on Mondays to focus on the Bad Batch, the current series on Disney Plus. But they're always talking everything Star Wars related and handling all the rumors in the correct fashion. All right, you get on these rabbit holes on YouTube of these people that claim they know shit and they don't. And Scott and company over there at Sarlacc will always set you straight on what is worth getting excited about in the Star Wars rumor mill. And if you're curious about what's going on with our Patreon business, please go on over to patreon.com/theholyhourpodcast and see what we have to offer over there and ways that you can contribute and really help the show out. We're totally appreciative of everyone that's partaking in that and anyone even curious. So go on over there and see if it's something that you'll be into. All right, now here we go when we talk about how not to drown. All right, here we are. Tonight, Chaz and I, we are talking the new hot single that's got all the Cure fans and CHVRCHES fans riled up out there. How Not to Drown. How's it going, Chaz?
Riled up in a good way and bad way.
Has it been mixed reviews? I feel like I've seen most.
Yeah.
All right.
You know what? I've seen more positive than negative.
Yeah.
But I've seen quite a lot of people that say they don't like it. So, we'll talk about that later. But
yeah,
let's get into
No, it's
this.
A good point. Yeah, I haven't really had the chance.
Our opinions matter most.
To hang on that. Yeah, we'll put them after us. But yes. Yeah, I haven't really had a chance to dig through the Facebook groups and stuff really to see too many opinions. So, cool.
Oh yeah, that's where I was going for the beef,
for the nitty gritty. Yeah. Well, yeah. Welcome everybody out there, and welcome Chaz. Like I said, we're going to talk about this new collaboration that came out June 2nd, and you know, we were like, should we even record it? What, the night of, maybe the next day? Then we had the long long weekend in between, so it's good that we've got some time now. It's still only, you know, what, like 5 days or so at the most, I think, since then. And so it's good. I think we've had a little bit more time to stew in it and see if our initial reactions are really what we really feel this new song. And so it's on. It's out there right now. It's the second single, I believe, or the second release song anyway, from iTunes perspective, of their new album, Screen Violence. I'm not sure when it comes out, but I'm assuming fairly soon.
August 27th, 2021.
Wow,
that is a while away.
Yeah, it's like the end of summer, I guess. That's okay. How it rolls now. They always just like release like 8 songs gradually by the time the album comes out now. I don't know if like Spotify does that too. I'm assuming they all do, right? Where it's like you just get like 1 song a month, you know, almost like.
Yeah.
Then it's just like by the end, you're getting the last 2 songs when you get the full album. It's like, jeez, what a buildup. But, so August, okay. So this could be the feel good hit of the summer, maybe. I don't know.
I don't know if I feel good, but it's
a hit.
It's definitely like a hit of the summer already for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. So, yeah, I guess just initial reaction then. Were you thumbs up or thumbs down?
Initial reaction, I didn't want to listen to it.
Yeah?
Out
of fear?
Part of it was fear, and I know I sent you a text about this, but the lead singer looks like an ex-girlfriend of mine, and it just kind of just like weird to watch it. So I was like, and then I was just like, I gotta get over this. And I listened to the song first before I watched the video.
Yeah.
I think I listened to it about 2 or 3 times, and then I was just like, all right, I gotta watch this stupid video.
Yeah.
And I loved it.
Cool.
Thought the video was great, pretty minimal, but kind of expected with COVID.
Yeah.
The animation I thought was pretty decent. Robert looked great, sounded great.
Yeah, much better than, I guess.
I
think we all know where I'm going with that.
Yeah, he doesn't look like a moon anymore. It's really weird. He lost that weight.
Yeah, he's not quite just floating out there in space.
That was ridiculous. This was a lot better. I felt it was very much like Paramore, kind of like a Paramore sound. I know Olivia Rodrigo. Is like the hot singer of the summer, and she has like that Paramore kind of poppy punk kind of sound to it.
Yeah.
But they're more of a synth band, I guess, but I'd never really listened to them before. Just cause I don't like that V, and it, that's like really, I don't know. Why does everybody do that now?
I don't know. I'm doing it even. my band Juncture, we had to do it. We switched it to a V. Because there's like 5 junk drawer bins, so I said let's be Javunk Drawer, and
you gotta be like Junk Drawer AD or junk
drawer, that's where we should have gone. I thought this was my attempt to be young and hip, I guess. So I figured if these kids could do it, why not, you know? So but yeah, it was always a little unsettling too. I was like, well, I'm never going to say this name out loud. I'm pretty sure it's just CHVRCHES, but I really don't want to be the dorky CHVRCHES old man that doesn't know how to pronounce this. But yeah, so you, I guess leading up into this, maybe a little CHVRCHES background, you hadn't really delved into their back catalog or would consider yourself familiar even, or just didn't even want to really touch it.
I mean, the other night, I stayed up till about 2:30 in the morning. I was listening to the song over and over again in bed.
Yeah.
And then I was just like, oh, I'm going to go down the rabbit hole and like listen to like 5 or 6 of their other songs.
Yeah.
It was It's not bad.
Yeah, it's weird. It's like, yeah, because it's kind of the same deal with me, I guess. They're like, because they started popping up. I felt like, I mean, they've been around a little while now, even though I still consider them, you know, she just looks just young. I even looked her up. She's like 33, you know. It's like, I just assume that they're all like 20 or something. And like, but yeah, like I remember, I want to say it was like some stereo gum pitchfork era, kind of like the last grasp of when I cared to look at that shit and stuff still, you know. And like, and they were like all over that and like kind of being billed as like this super new indie band and stuff. And I recall her like dropping like The Cure a lot, like, and wearing t-shirts, like Cure shirts and shit, you know. It like came up numerous times that she was like clearly a legit Cure fan, you know. And I was just like, okay, well, for that I'll give them a chance. And it was kind of always that reaction each time. I was like, the synths are cool. It's like, and she sounds cool. The songs are like catchy. It was like, but this is like just straight up pop. This isn't like indie band, you know, like, you know, just like cool, you know, and being a, you know, closet pop whore myself, I usually, I mean, that isn't really a negative thing. I'm like, all right, I'll still listen to it if it's catchy and stuff. But so they never really caught me though. You know, it was always just a little too much. It's a little too Paramore, like you're saying, or something, or it was just a little too, like, not that far from a, like, a Taylor Swift gets crazy with a synthesizer kind of song or something in my books, which I know they would be deeply offended probably if they heard me say that. But it's just like, you know, it's not really that much of an insult, but at the same time, it's like, this feels very like what pop radio should be to me. I feel like these are like, these are the songs, I don't even know how successful, I'm assuming they're huge, but I never really hear them on, like, the pop radio when I do get in the car and occasionally just don't have a CD or whatever. And I throw on pop radio just to hear what's going on, you know, and it's never shit like this, you know, but it should be, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I just, you know, I had heard of the band and seen that name before. It just, it really wasn't on, like, it never went across my radar. Like they weren't playing at like a festival I was going to, or, you know, nothing that where I'd be like, oh, I'll go check them out because I'm going in that direction sort of thing.
Right.
But yeah. And like the Paramore comparison isn't a bad thing. And it's like, it's like, it's pop and it's like a very powerful pop kind of song, like kind of in your face. Like, and I really like this song. I'm speaking about, not so much like all their stuff, because I don't want to, I'm probably sounding ignorant because I don't know their whole catalog.
Right.
So, but just based on the pop stuff that, like the stuff that I heard on YouTube, it was, you know, it's pop. It's very stereo or radio friendly pop.
Yeah.
And I like it. You know, I'm just saying it is what it is. And I, you know, I think that was a lot of the blowback that I saw from this, is just like somebody was like, this is too poppy.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, have you, like, and you're a fan of The Cure. I'm like, I don't.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, if, like they are essentially a pop band.
Yeah. And
like, it's like, that's what they do. And that's their biggest hits. And like, this is just another extension of that, I felt like.
Yeah, for sure.
So
yeah, the few negative ones I saw in groups are just initial reactions. It was people more just saying that they straight up don't like churches, you know, didn't even really have a valid argument against of like what Robert's contribution was or the song, or, you know, it was just like, I just don't like her voice. I just never have liked them, you know? And it was like, okay. So it was just kind of like a bam, not even really giving it a chance. The few that I saw was like,
that's
that.
Stupid.
So, yeah. So I was just like,
I mean, I don't like the Gorillaz, but I still gave that song a chance.
Yeah.
You know? So. And it's just there. I like her voice. There's nothing, I don't know.
Yeah.
Like there's nothing that like I could pick out of it where that's like bad.
Yeah.
You know, or annoying. The only complaint that I would have, and maybe it was a production thing, was that Robert's voice was a little too low in the beginning.
Yeah.
And then at the end, I guess, but I think that was on purpose.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was the only complaint that I really heard as a production wise, but like the only, like everything else was just based on it's too poppy.
Yeah.
And I'm, like, I don't know what you want.
Right.
Like, what do you want?
Yeah. It's crazy. And I don't know. I mean, I guess getting into like initial reactions and still like initially I was like, whoa, this is poppy. But then I like it, you know, and I like to hear.
Yeah.
I like Robert being on it because no matter what at this stage with The Cure or whatever he's, you know, collaborating on, you're never really going to get that much like young pop energy out of Robert at this part. And that's not even a complaint either. Yeah. The dude's 62, you know, it's like, so it's great to like see him in that and have to just like hang, and he totally hangs in there. And like, you know, he doesn't sound like old man stepping in for a verse at all to me. It's like, it's seamless,
absolutely.
You know, it's like really carries the song too. And it does fit, you know. Initially I was going to be like, this is going to sound weird if he just comes in the middle of this, you know, even on first listen.
Yeah.
But yeah, they pull it off. It is like a great just pop gem in that regards too. And nice that it is more of like a traditional duet in the sense of unlike the Gorillaz one, even though probably shouldn't compare the two, but all the time, you know, we're going to have to in the sense of just that's the only two songs we have with him in the past, whatever. But, you know, it's nice that it was like, you know, he's going to take this and they're going to sing the chorus, and it was, you know, a little more just straightforward, I thought was cool. I liked seeing him in that environment again, you know, and singing something that poppy and like energetic, like had like a big pop sound to it, was cool. So I'm all for it too. So, yeah.
I've heard worse things that he's done, and like as far as collabs go, and I'm sure there's worse ideas out there that he's been pitched.
Yeah.
And this is a band that if they went on tour next year, if they brought them along, I would be completely okay with it. Like it's a sound that I wouldn't like kind of roll my eyes trying to get through this band. Kind of like what the hell was the name of the Twilight Sad.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, this is cool, you know, and then I dove into their catalog because they were going on tour with them.
Yeah.
I'm happy with every aspect of this.
Yeah.
And even Robert in his best raccoon makeup, he still looks great.
Yeah, going back to the video, it was cool. Like you said, it was very, you could tell, probably COVID-related in the sense that everyone seemed a little isolated, and it was like just tricks you would do on your computer with footage of random shots of microphones and bats and shit. It's like, all right, cool, whatever. But yeah, definitely didn't do anything to hurt the song or make them look goofy. He looked great. He didn't seem to have any like noticeably different, you know, features since the last time we saw him, which was good. You know, he wasn't going to reinvent a new image or have any noticeable wounds.
Still holding
or anything.
On to it.
Yeah. So it's still classic Robert. So that was kind of reassuring too, that everything was still where it should be. So, I was going to catch the bass player's polka dot shirt there. It was
yes, I did. Yeah.
A cool, most likely nod to Robert. That would just be a weird chance if it wasn't, but seemed to be a cool nod to the Disintegration era shirt that we, was almost identical. I think I didn't really pause it to see, but it definitely looked in that vein. So
he should have gone to Kate and got one of those cat sweaters.
Yeah, totally. The Love Cats one. Totally. Yeah, maybe we'll do that for the next one. But they seem like a cool band. Those interviews that tag along with these are all cool. That's kind of the fun part of these collaborations, is we get a song with Robert on it and we get even just a slight snippet of some kind of interview or conversation and other information, which we'll talk about too briefly. But it was cool just seeing them talk and kind of gush over having Robert on there and stuff, which was cool. I guess we gotta give credit to that. What was it on Zane Lowe's show, Apple One Music? So that and the little Zoom they had going before the video premiere were cool. And just seeing them of how like impressed they were and flattered that Robert was going to be a part of it. And going back to what you're saying, and he kind of touched on that with the Gorillaz one too, is that there are more requests for him to collaborate than you would think out there. And you know, he said something along the lines of you know, I you know, there's a lot of ones that I even like that I don't do for whatever reason, timing, or just don't think it'll fit. But so of course, the nerd side of me was like, oh man, I wish there was somehow a list of the ones that he definitely turned down just because he didn't like, you know, like the band at all, you know? So I'd be so curious to see, but we'll never get that dirt. But wonder how one far of the it stretches.
Compared to like the Gorillaz, because we kind of have to, we do have to compare the two.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, not that the Gorillaz aren't fans of The Cure and Robert Smith.
Mm-hmm.
It just felt a little different coming from this band that, you know, idolizes him.
Yeah.
In like a way that maybe the Gorillaz don't. But I'm just speaking from the reaction of like how excited they were.
Yeah.
That he said yes. Right. Which is always charming. And I can only imagine what it'd be like to work with your hero for like just one song.
Yeah.
And even
just the structure of the two songs, you see that a bit, I think, in the sense of like, and if I understood them correctly in the little interview segments, CHVRCHES sounded like they gave Robert like a whole stack of songs or whatever from this album, and it was kind of like, well, what are you interested in, like which ones, like where they kind of found the song and the part, you know, like, and then kind of fit him in. And it does sound like that bit more. And again, it almost sounds like a complaint, but I'm not sure it is, in the sense that it's like that this is pretty much just a full-on CHVRCHES song where he's just singing the second verse. And like, I would be shocked if he even wrote any of the lyrics or anything, which I don't even know if they said anything along those lines. But it does
probably
just,
not.
Yeah, yeah, it just feels like he's totally singing their song. But that's what it is, you know. It's a CHVRCHES song with Robert Smith. It's not The Cure with them or anything like that. So. But yeah, it does feel like it's structure-wise, we have this, we know Robert Smith's awesome and he could fit into this. Well, like Gorillaz almost felt like more like Damon was also a compliment, I guess, in the sense he's so confident in Robert Smith being able to do anything, you know, like,
yeah,
because it seems like they knew that he would just come up with some crazy part or something and then he could come up with something, you know, like almost seems more of like a abstract painting they're doing together or something, and then he's gonna put all the pieces together, but you don't really know but it was almost more faith in his like you know, wackiness of the past Cure songs of being able to do anything, you know, and it would be cool, while the CHVRCHES song seems a little bit more like, this is just a great pop song, he'll make it sound great because he's, you know, done this a million times, you know. So if that makes sense.
yeah, it really does. And but I mean, in the same right, Robert kind of makes this, which it overshadows your single now, because I think Robert made so much of this song like his own.
Yeah.
That it's going to be impossible to separate the two now, and you're going to see it live every once in a while when their, you know, their festival paths cross.
Right.
And Robert's available to come up on stage and do that song.
Yeah.
But yeah, his part in that song is so, it was like almost Johnny Cash hurt like.
Yeah.
Because there was so like, there's like emotion behind it, that you don't normally hear, like you don't hear in a collab to begin with.
Yeah.
But it was like, it was almost like he made it. He associated himself somewhat to those lyrics and like felt them while he sang them.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. Like, yeah. I really felt like that he, especially that end part where it's just him and it's just like, it gave me goosebumps. Like, each time I heard it.
Yeah, it was funny because on first listen, I was kind of like, what is this part? Like, it almost just felt like, damn, the pop song's over. How can we just keep Robert Smith singing anything, you know, just to keep it going?
Yeah.
At first I wasn't like totally on board just songwriter wise, but then with every listen since, I'm like, oh, that part's like rad, because it is just kind of like that feeling it and fading out with the emotion and stuff, and like it works, it's really cool, and it gets more of him in there. So
yeah, I was like, I was panicking after his part was over and it the song kept going and kept going. And I'm just like, oh, man, I guess that was it. And then it comes in at the end. I'm like, yes. So, and I was hoping it wasn't going to end.
Because he is pretty blended in on the choruses, too. When they're both singing together, he's like kind of one of 56 different vocal tracks. It's like, so I was kind of like, oh, man, he got that one really cool verse in, but that was going to be it if he didn't have that cool outro thing. So, definitely.
Yeah. Oh. Overall, I thought the song was a little, like, just complaint is just, I thought it was a little too long. It's 5.5 minutes.
Yeah.
There's, like, that bridge part that, like, I don't really think
is it does kind of stretch
needed.
It.
It's, yeah. But I think that was the only complaint that I would have about the song. I think it was perfect the way they did it, the way it sounds, how they fit him in, how they mix him in the chorus, and how he ended the song. So I thought that was perfect. So, and that's, again, not something you generally hear with collabs. I admire that, giving that to him.
If anything, when listening to it though too, and I'm sure a lot of it's just wanting more Cure and more Robert, but it definitely did leave me wanting more, even though the song is longer and drags a little almost. Like where it just
I want more of him. I don't, like, he could have kept going for another minute and a half.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't get a shit, but I still would have said that bridge was too long.
Yeah.
And, like, you need to get to him quicker.
Because it pretty much is the choruses over and over. Yeah, I think they repeat the choruses like 4 times at the end or something. But yeah, it was funny, almost to the point, though, where I was like, oh, I want more, which is good. But also I was like, man, if this had been like a CD single, we'd have at least like 4 remixes and shit, too. I was like, for the first time in my life, maybe ever, like, wanting of like, ooh, a remix would be great of this, where you could hear like a slightly different. It's like, oh, no, I'm falling for it. But yeah, I think that's probably more just like getting a cup of water in the desert, you know, where I'm like, oh, come on.
That's what I felt like the Gorillaz collab was.
Yeah.
This felt like a lot better.
Yeah.
The
Gorillaz one is really just singing one line over and over.
Yeah. And this is one that I listened to it twice today.
Yeah.
Since it came out and I actually listened to it, I think I've listened to it like at least 3 or 4 times a day since then.
Yeah, me too. So I've had it on a steady loop.
But also that's part of that I want something more from Robert.
Right.
So
I guess maybe that's a good time to segue. Like we said, not only did we get a new song and a new collaboration with this, we get a slight little sliver of some updates into the brain of Robert, which is always nice, but at the same time frustrating. And I don't know. I guess it depends on which glass half empty, half full kind of thing. Do you want to let yourself get excited at this point, or do you just take it as what it is? So in case anybody did miss those little segments, we figured we could recap those with a couple thoughts on what the hell. So the interviewer breaks away from the song for a split second there and basically says, what's up with the Cure stuff? Is anything coming out? Has this all been a trick? And then Robert tells some good stuff, but then the most like compelling part, he drops that in 6 weeks' time, it's like turning into like a Zelda game or some shit at this point. If you unlock,
it's very biblical.
Yeah, it's 6 weeks.
On the sixth day of the sixth hour.
6 weeks. So in 6 weeks' time, which if I did the math right, would be about mid-July. So like maybe the teens of July, I think. I'll be allowed, I think he might have said the word allowed at one point, to disclose all the release information, basically, of like what's coming out when, I think is what he said. So in 6 weeks, he's going to have some kind of announcement of what's coming out in regards to releases and plans, probably touring for the next year. So
I'm going to talk about what he didn't say.
Okay.
And that is that he's allowed to talk about it in 6 weeks.
Yeah.
But that does not mean that he is going to talk about it in 6 weeks.
Right. So, yeah, exactly.
We have no idea what he's going to say in 6 weeks.
Yeah. So that he's like, yeah. It's like he doesn't, or maybe he does have a label. I don't know. I don't even know who's like telling him he can't say anything.
It's probably his agent at this point.
Yeah, or his wife.
Yeah.
It's like, quit saying shit. You can't.
Yeah.
But and you know, most realistically, the pessimistic side of being a Cure fan here is like his announcement will be that nothing's coming out anytime till next year.
We're still mixing the album.
It's still, yeah, that was the part I texted him. It was like everything was like this, and then all I really have to do is just find who's gonna mix the album, and they'll be right. I'm like, wait, no, who's gonna mix? I thought you were already mixing the album. I thought you've been mixing the album all year. You said that you.
You've been stuck inside for a year and a half. What the fuck are you doing? Stop doing collabs and mix the goddamn album.
Yeah, so I was like, oh man, he still has to mix it. Yeah. So, or maybe it's because. And then the other big nugget was he's pretty much back on this three albums thing, and it sounded a little bit more legit than ever, the three albums thing, because I, you know, was shocked because I pretty much had written that off from the first review, or it's, we're never gonna get fucking three albums, come on man. It's like, but so yeah, he was leaning real heavy on the noise one, which I thought was gonna be the first one to never hear about again, but he said that's merging now into the solo album, which is an even bigger laugh, as you can refer back to our solo album episode where he's been talking about that since 1983. But it made sense. He was saying if he does have this noisy kind of just experimental album, he doesn't want to put it out as a Cure record because it's like you've waited 13 years or whatever, and this is the next Cure album, which who knows, might be cool, but I could totally see why the rest of the band, that he wouldn't want that to be their big, you know, comeback album or whatever. So he's acting like that's going to be the solo album if it ever sees the light of day. And then there's the Doom and Gloom album, which is the one we've been hearing about for 2 years or whatever plus at this point. And then he says, and a not Doom and Gloom album. And the way he phrased it made it sound like they've all been like, done, and they're at the same pace as far as like ready to roll. Both of them just need to be mixed, they're ready to roll. So I don't know, I mean, but what the fuck does that mean? Like, maybe that's why it's taking so long, is because he's trying to mix and record two whole completely different albums at the same time. But who are we to question genius?
Can you imagine if we waited all this time and he strung us along all like just over the last like 2 years or so, and all we get is a noise album.
Yeah, I definitely would be a little like, okay. In like a great like, wow, way to still keep us on our toes, Robert. I'd be impressed if it was that, you know. And how great would it be if Donald's the only one that likes the new? He would love that. It's like, how did this work, man? It's like, he didn't give a shit about any of this. He hasn't cried once over this. And now he's the only one that's happy?
I mean, I'm not holding my breath for any of the albums to be released. Well, definitely not this year or even like early next year. It kind of falls in line with everybody else, but I feel like that this is going to be a jumping off point for a tour.
Yeah.
Tour announcement. Just because you see all these other bands.
Yeah.
Like announcing their tours that they. Sorry, my dogs are playing.
Uh-uh.
Stop. like all these bands are announcing their tours, or the tours that got canceled, they're putting those back on.
Right.
Some festivals are coming out. So it would make sense that they announce a tour in the next couple weeks or so. Month or 2 months. So
it's gotta be like be a legit tour too, right? I mean, if they just do another year of festivals,
I will lose my goddamn mind.
That would just kill me.
I can't do it.
It's like I would be so happy that they're doing it, but at the same time, I'd just be like, "What the hell, dude?" It's like, and then he'll be like, "Well, we just needed a year to rebound touring, so we did some festival dates. I could totally see that happening, though, too, you know? And then, like, they put out the new album of, like, what, like, fall of 2022 after they've done summer testicles festivals. After they've done a string of summer testicles.
Summer testicles.
Yeah. So, I don't know, man. Yeah, I mean, luckily it's so convoluted now that, like, the shit could come out, like, you know, fall of this year, like, never. I don't know. I mean, anyone's guess is, it's kind of nicer that way now than it is. Like, who knows? Maybe, you know, could still just show up any day now. Who knows?
But if I had a guess, I have a feeling that it's going to be close to a repeat of the 2016 tour, where it was the United States, North America, for the first couple months, and then they do the festival circuit, and then, you know, around the country and elsewhere, and then they finish up in Europe in the fall.
Yeah.
Or other countries, you know, whatever. But I that's how I feel that they're gonna go with the next tour.
Yeah.
Since they didn't come to the United States during that last festival run, right?
They did 2019. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't a ton of them. They did Austin, St. Louis, and they did, like, that was like the Pasadena one and stuff. Was that?
Yeah.
But not a ton. Yeah, compared to all the other European ones and such. But so I mean,
yeah, that's what I envision. I don't envision an album release date or anything like that, especially once he said mixing. I just kind of rolled my eyes and was like, all right, we're not going to. Yeah.
But
yeah,
I mean, technically, he does have enough time. I mean, even though mixing isn't something you can just, like, crank out in a day, especially the Cure. But but there's a lot of year left still, too. So if everything's kind of gearing up towards, like, April of next year, like when they like to release albums and shit, I mean, it could be out by then, you know? So I mean, that makes sense. There's a lot of year left still, like half the year, you know, he could mix the damn things, hopefully.
you would hope so.
You would think, but so I don't know.
Yeah. I think a label needs kind of concrete you know, information and like a due date to actually put that out there into the world, like May 21st.
Yeah, exactly. Like, okay, it's gotta be done by then. So but yeah, I mean, if it's another 2016 kind of tour, I think everybody would be fine. Even like, album or no album, who gives a shit at that point? Yeah, it's like if they're doing like legit shows and stuff, and it's not some, you know, Lollapalooza crap or something. You know, I think would be good. I don't know.
I just want a road trip to a couple shows.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, realistically, and everybody listen, that this could be the last chance you're going to see them if they tour.
Yeah.
You know, you have to take into account their age, and, you know, I'm sure they don't want to tour forever.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah, it's more legit now than ever.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the fact that they're not saying it's the last tour and shit means it probably would be more. Yeah. It's always when they don't announce that it's the last tour. Those are the ones you got to watch out for. But
All I'm saying is if they're playing three concerts within, you know, a 4 or 5 hour drive of your house, I would go to each one of them.
Yeah,
just my opinion. But
sounds good.
So, hopefully, if the finances allow,
hopefully that'll be the announcement in some form or another. I think this will just be a good test.
Here's the thing that, like, that I don't know if he understands is that they will be bigger than they've been since Wish.
Yeah.
You know, I think, you know, just as far as like anticipation wise and touring wise and the want for them to come on tour and put out more music, I don't, like, this is gonna be, because they were surprised in 2016, and this, like, the fact that everybody's been inside for a year and a half, you know,
this
you're
could
gonna
be
sell
huge
out every single date. Yeah.
Yeah, especially with these little things like this where they keep their... I mean, and everybody... It was so kind of even going back to the church's single of, like, how nice it is to see just this kind of glowing about The Cure and Robert and stuff that we didn't see for so long. It always kind of bothered me that The Cure never got, like, the recognition of, like, broken up, like, classic alternative bands and stuff, you know? Like,
yeah.
You know, and I think I always credit it towards a band doesn't really want to praise and credit an influence of a band that's still going, you know? So it's always easier to just be like The Smiths, REM, and stuff like that, you know? And like really praise the Joy Division even more than New Order, even like, you know, people always want to say New Order, but they'll say Joy Division a lot of times just to, you know, cause it sounds cooler, you know? You can't have any threat of like the sound coming back to bite you in the ass as an influence as a band, you know? Like if The Cure put out like a disco album or something after you just said they're your main influence, then it makes you look stupid too. But if it's some broken up band, you know, that it's so much cooler to say they were your main influence. So I always felt like The Cure always got the shaft on that a bit, you know, where nobody ever praised them. And now we're seeing more and more bands, whether they're working with them or just citing them, you know. And there's a little of that in that weird 2004 era, but it was all like these bands that I wasn't really like Marilyn Manson and shit. And I'm just like, they're not the ones that should be like crazy. It should be every like cool pop band. And like, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I think we're starting to see that more and more. And I, like going back to what you're saying of like, you know, they could make this their biggest tour ever. You know, I think there is. You got like enough kids that are getting into them now. You got, you know, like the geezers aren't quite too old yet to make it out. I think we can all get out there. You
know? Yeah. I mean, I want to bring my oldest son because he wants to see them. And, you know, there's something there, you know. And then they did they just added to the want to see them with that performance in Australia.
Yeah.
With Disintegration, you know, and, I think, you know, and then the 40th anniversary sparked, you know, a groundswell. So this is just even more. So I want to see like a legit, you know, 89, 92 world tour kind of feeling, you know, where they go to every major city.
Yeah.
So, which would be nice, but I hope, but you know.
Yeah,
we'll see.
It'd be tough, but he could do it.
And we will be at as many as possible.
Yes,
and,
I think so.
You know,
mark our words now. Yes. Yeah, for
even
sure.
Even if we can't get into the concert, we'll be outside saying hi.
Yeah, taking origin stories down and everything. So.
Yeah,
reporting.
And Kate and I will be slinging merch.
Yeah. So. Oh yes, it's a wonderful dream. So I think hopefully we'll hear some good news in 6 weeks, and
hopefully
and I guess just final thoughts on the song. Again, I think it's a nice pop gem. You know, I don't know if it's their best collaboration or his best collaboration, but maybe, I don't know, it's definitely a lot better than a lot of the other ones from the past that haven't been too mind-blowing, but I'd put it somewhere near the top.
It'd be in the top three or so.
It's a weird category.
It is a weird category, but it's something that you know, he's done, and it needs to be represented. It needs to be talked about, I guess. But
we should do a whole episode on that. I don't think we have still. So I briefly mentioned them in like episode 3 or something. I just kind of did like a playlist I made or something of them, but we should dive into
should
all the collaborations he's ever done. So
absolutely, I'm down for that.
Cool. All right, man, any other final thoughts, I guess, before we sign off? We'll keep this somewhere in between a half hour and an hour, I guess. Mysterious.
Listen to the song even if you don't like the band. Don't be one of those gatekeeper types. And just enjoy it for what it is. And save your money up.
Yes. Exactly. It ain't gonna be cheap, kids.
Yeah, but... yeah. This is That tour is not gonna be cheap.
No.
Yeah. So.
But worth every penny if it happens.
Yes, it will be. Yes, it will be. Absolutely.
Cool. Well, I couldn't agree more, man. And thanks for sharing your thoughts on this song. I totally agree too. Go put it on out there, and check out the rest of that album too. The other single's pretty decent. So we'll see. Once we get it all in August.
I'm definitely gonna listen to the whole album in August. I want to see how the rest of the album stands up to that song.
Yeah.
If the rest of the songs are anywhere close to that one, it'll be a good album.
Yeah. So, cool deal. Yeah. All right, guys. Well, take care out there. Thank you, Chaz. And till next time, maybe we'll have a quick rundown of after this 6 weeks. Let's see what happens.
Yeah.
Till then, talk hard, sleep tight. 'Cause that song is catchy. Even just plugging it in here to make this episode has me singing along. So yeah, it grows on you each listen. So go dig it up, see what you can find, what you think. And thanks so much for listening. We'll be back soon with another new episode. Be sure to subscribe on Apple Music and follow us on the Instagram at the Holy Hour Podcast and our Facebook page where you can chime in with your 2 cents. And we'll also put a link to those interviews in little segments there. So if you missed those somehow, you can find it all over there on the Facebook page, the Holy Hour Podcast on Facebook. All our episodes are also available on YouTube if that's your desired podcast world. And you can also find some video playlists over there and all kinds of extra stuff. So be sure to check that out. If you're into that kind of thing, you can always email me directly at gavinconnor@gmail.com if you have any questions or suggestions for episodes or overall complaints. So feel free to drop anything my way. And we'll catch you soon. On top of all that, be sure to check out 17secondshirts.bigcartel.com. That's Chaz's site there, where he's always coming up with clever and cool and beautiful Cure t-shirt designs that you can pre-order and really add some zest to your Cure wardrobe. So go check that out and just follow him on Instagram, 17_seconds, if you don't want to mess with that whole cartel thing. So on top of all that, we'll catch you soon, and talk hard.